this lecture, we are going to start with the next chapter of nuclear and particle physics, the radiation detectors or the particle detectors. So as their name suggests, these are the instruments which help us in detecting the nuclear radiations. So nuclear radiations are like alpha particle, beta particle, deuteron or gamma radiations. So these are some of the examples of nuclear radiations which are emitted in a nuclear reaction. So the radiation detectors, they help us in detecting these particles, and they also help us in providing the information about these nuclear radiations. So they give us the information about these nuclear radiations which are emitted in a nuclear reaction. So what kind of information? They help us in finding the momentum. They also help us in identifying the spin, the charge which is carried by the nuclear radiation, and also the energy. So what is the energy which is carried by the nuclear radiation? So that we can find with the help of these radiation detectors. So in a nuclear reaction, how do we see that an alpha particle is emitted, a beta particle is emitted, or gamma radiations are emitted? So how can we identify which kind of particle is emitted? So that we can find with the help of these detectors. These detectors, they help us in identifying the type of nuclear radiation which is emitted in a nuclear reaction. So in a radiation detector, there is some material. So the radiation detector has the main component, which is the medium. So in this medium, the incoming nuclear radiation, it passes through the medium of the detector and it transfers its energy. The nuclear radiation transfers its energy to the atoms or molecules of the medium of the detector. So the main criteria how the nuclear radiations are detected with the help of these radiation detectors, the main criteria is that there must be a dissipation of energy in the detector by that radiation. So the incoming alpha particle or beta particle or any nuclear radiation must transfer its energy to the medium of the detector. Only then the particle, the incoming particle, can be detected. So if there is no dissipation of energy, if the incoming particle does not transfer its energy at all and it passes as it is through the detector, then obviously there will be no detection. So the incoming particle, the incoming nuclear radiation, must transfer its energy to the medium of the detector. Only then the particle can be detected by that instrument. So by dissipation of energy, we mean that there can be ionizations. So when a nuclear radiation like alpha, beta or gamma radiation or any nuclear radiation, when it passes through the medium of the detector, it can cause ionizations. So it will cause ionizations, means the medium, the atoms of the medium of the detector will be divided into a positive ion and an electron. So there will be ionizations. So dissipation of energy can be in two forms. First is ionizations, and ionizations occur in the case of ionization counter. So this is one of the types of the radiation detectors. So in ionization counter, we will see that there are ionizations that happen inside the medium of the detector, and ionizations also occur in the case of proportional counter. And also in the case of GM counter. So this topic, GM counter, is very important. So in the case of GM counter also, ionizations occur in the medium of the detector. And another way of transferring the energy of the nuclear radiation, so another way is by excitations. So the nuclear radiation, the alpha, beta or gamma ray, what they do is they just excite the atoms of the medium of the detector. So they do not do the complete ionization. So what they do is they excite the atoms. So they dissipate their energy by excitations. So this happen in the case of scintillation counter. So this is also a very important topic, scintillation counter. So in the case of scintillation counter, excitations are made to have the excitations occur in the medium of this detector. Now the radiation detectors that we are going to do can be classified into two main types. First are the gas filled detectors and second one are the solid state detectors. So in the case of gas filled detectors, we will have the medium as the gaseous medium. So we have been talking about the medium of the detector. So gas filled detectors are the ones which have a gaseous medium. And the solid state detectors, they have a solid medium. So examples of the gas filled detectors are ionization counter. So we will be looking at every type of counter, every type of detector one by one. So first is the ionization counter, second one proportional counter, and last one is the Geiger-Müller counter or simply GM counter. So Geiger-Müller counter or simply GM counter. So these detectors, they come under gas filled detectors as the medium that is present is in gaseous form. So example of solid state detectors is the scintillation counter. And second one is the semiconductor detector. So in this case, we have a semiconductor as the medium. So these are the five types of detectors which are a part of our syllabus, and we will be looking at every type of detector one by one. So first of all, we are going to see the gas filled detectors. We will see their basic construction and the basic principle, their basic working. Now we are going to look at the basic construction and principle of gas filled detectors. So first of all, we are going to look at the construction. So gas filled detector consists of a cylindrical conducting chamber. So over here, this cylindrical chamber shown by black color. So this is a cylindrical conducting chamber and this is hollow from inside. And there is a thin axial wire. So there is a thin wire shown by this red color. So this is a thin axial wire which is present inside the chamber. So this cylindrical conducting cylindrical chamber, this is hollow from inside, and inside this chamber there is a thin axial wire which is present along the axis of the cylinder. Then this axial wire is insulated from the chamber with the help of some insulators shown over here. Now this whole system is placed inside a glass envelope. So there is some insulator. So this whole system of chamber and this axial wire is present inside this glass envelope shown by blue color. Now there is some suitable gas present inside this chamber. So a suitable gas is contained inside this chamber, inside this black conducting chamber shown over here. Now this thin wire and the walls of the chamber, the thin wire and the walls of the chamber, they are applied an external voltage. So an external voltage is applied to this chamber and this thin wire. So this thin wire is attached to the positive terminal of the external voltage, and this chamber, walls of the chamber, they are connected to the negative terminal of the external voltage through a resistor. So there is a resistance present, and this thin wire and the conducting chamber, they are connected to the external voltage. So this thin wire, as I have said, that this is attached to the positive terminal, so this acts as anode and it is insulated from the chamber walls. So this anode wire, this is insulated from the chamber walls with the help of some insulators. And this cylindrical conducting chamber, this is connected to negative terminal, so this will act as cathode. So this you have to remember, that the conducting chamber, this cylindrical conducting chamber, is connected to negative terminal, so it will act as cathode, and this thin wire acts as anode. Now the external voltage is applied between the walls of the chamber and the axial wire through a resistance R. There will be electric field set up inside the chamber. So due to the external voltage, as we have applied a potential difference to this wire and the walls of the chamber, due to this external voltage, due to this potential difference, obviously there will be some electric field set up, and this electric field which is set up inside the chamber, this will be directed from the wire towards the walls of the chamber, because the direction of electric field is always taken from the positive towards the negative charge. Since this wire is connected to the positive terminal of the external voltage and the chamber walls act as cathode, means they are connected to the negative terminal, so the electric field inside this chamber will be directing from the axial wire towards the walls of the chamber. Similarly, in the downward direction also, in the downward portion also, the electric field will direct from the anode wire towards the walls of the chamber. Now what is the working? So this was the basic construction, that there is a cylindrical chamber, there is axial wire, and the system is enclosed inside a glass envelope which is an insulator, and the axial wire acts as anode and the walls of the chamber, they act as cathode, and there is some gas, suitable gas, which is contained inside this chamber. Now what is the working? So for the working of a gas field detector, let's suppose that there is some incoming particle, let's say alpha particle, passes through this detector. So some alpha particle, some charged particle, let's say it passes through this detector. When this alpha particle will pass through the gas which is present inside this detector, so this alpha particle will make ionizations. This alpha particle will ionize the gas as it will pass through the detector. So you can see that as the alpha particle passes, on its way it has ionized the gas atoms or molecules. So there will be some positive ion and electron, and similarly there will be positive ion and electron, and similarly to on the whole path of the alpha particle inside the chamber, the gas molecules will get ionized in this manner. So these are called as the primary ionizations. These are called as primary ionizations. Primary ionizations are the one which are made directly by the incoming particle. So the alpha particle passes through the gas and it makes ionizations. The gas gets ionized. So those are called as primary ionizations. Now, as we have a positive ion and the electron, so these positive ion and the electrons, they will start drifting under the influence of electric field. So we have already applied the external voltage, and due to which there will be some electric field set up inside the chamber, and this electric field will direct from the anode towards the cathode. Now these positive ions, they will start to drift, they will drift towards the cathode. So positive ions will drift towards the negative electrode, means the cathode, or you can say the chamber walls, and the electrons will start drift, they will start to drift towards the anode wire. So they will start moving towards the anode wire. So when these electrons will reach the anode wire, then they will move in this circuit, they will flow in this circuit, and hence a potential drop, a pulse signal will be observed across the resistance R. So when these electrons and positive ions, they are formed due to the incoming particle, any incoming particle. So these electrons, they will drift towards the anode and positive ions will drift towards the cathode. Now when these electrons will reach the anode wire, when they will reach the anode wire, they will flow in the circuit and hence a pulse signal will be observed, a potential drop will be observed across the resistance R. So observation of this pulse signal means that some particle has entered the detector. So pulse signal is observed when electrons flow in the circuit. When the electrons flow in the circuit, a pulse signal will be observed across the resistance R. And electrons will flow only when electrons will reach the anode wire. So electrons will flow in the circuit when electrons reach this anode wire. Only then these electrons will flow. And these electrons are formed due to the incoming particle, which means pulse signal is observed only when some particle, some charged particle enters this detector. So only then primary ionizations will be made and hence some pulse signal will be observed. And if this alpha particle, it passes through this detector without making any ionizations, without making any primary ionizations, there will be no pulse signal and hence that particle will not be detected. So this is the basic working of a gas field detector. When any ionizing radiation passes through the gas atoms or the molecules are ionized into positive ion and electron. So we have a positive ion and electron. In the absence of any electric field, when there is no electric field, electrons and the positive ions recombine with each other. So when there is no electric field means we have not applied any external voltage, these positive ions and electron will recombine with each other. So there will be no pulse signal. So in the absence of any electric field, electrons and positive ions recombine, and this recombination also occurs when the external voltage is very small. When the external voltage is very small means this electric field is not sufficient to separate these positive ion and the electron. So what is the working of this electric field? This electric field helps the electrons to move towards the anode and the positive ions, they move towards the cathode. So this electric field makes the electrons reach the anode and hence a pulse signal is observed. Now if this electric field is not sufficient enough to separate these positive ions and the electrons, what happens that these positive ions and electrons, they recombine with each other. So the attractive force between the positive ion and the electrons is greater than the force due to the electric field. So this electric field is not sufficient enough to separate these positive ions and the electrons when the external voltage is small. So in that case also the positive ions and electrons recombine with each other, and that we will study in the case of recombination region. So in the absence of an electric field, or you can say when the external voltage is very small, the electrons and the positive ions recombine with each other. However, when there is enough electric field applied, when enough sufficient electric field is present, in that case electrons drift towards the anode, means the central wire, and the positive ions drift towards the cathode, means the walls of the chamber, and due to which a pulse signal across the resistance R is obtained and that is detected. So a pulse signal is obtained means the incoming particle has been detected. Now this height of the pulse signal, as I have shown that a pulse signal is observed across the resistance R, so the height of this pulse signal, it depends upon two main factors. First is the type of the incoming particle. Now let's say if alpha particle enters the detector and A beta particle enters the detector. So now we are going to study the two conditions when alpha particle enters and the beta particle enters the same detector. Now we know that the alpha particle has more ionizing power as compared to the beta particle. So this you have already studied in your high school, that alpha particle has less penetration power but more ionizing power. And the beta particle has more penetration power but less ionizing power as compared to the alpha particle. So alpha particle will make more ionizations inside the detector, whereas the beta particle of same energy will make less number of primary ionizations. So alpha particle will make more primary ionizations, more positive ion and electron pairs are formed in case of alpha particle, and less number of the positive ion and electron pair are formed in case of beta particle. So if you have alpha particle, then more number of electrons will reach the anode wire and hence there will be more current. So the pulse's height, the height of this signal will be more in case of alpha particle. So in case of beta particle, less number of primary ionizations will be made. Then correspondingly, less number of electrons will reach the anode wire and hence the pulse signal's height will be small in the case of beta particle. So the pulse signal height for the case of alpha is more as compared to the beta particle of same energy. So the pulse signal height of the pulse signal depends upon two factors. First is the type of the ionizing particle. Then second main factor is the external voltage. So here I am going to give you just a small information about how the height of the pulse signal depends upon the external voltage. Now if you have external voltage, means there is some electric field applied, there will be some electric field set up inside the chamber. And these electrons, they move under the influence of the electric field. The positive ions and the electrons which are formed, they move under the influence of this electric field. Now, electric field means there will be some force. So, there will be some force due to this electric field. Now, force on any charge is given by charge times the electric field. So, if there is electric field, means there will be force on that charge. And correspondingly, force, as we know, this is given by mass times acceleration. So if there is a force on a charge, then there will be acceleration. So due to the electric field, due to the presence of this electric field, there will be force acting on these electrons, and due to which these electrons will move towards the anode wire. Due to the effect of the force, these electrons will move towards the central wire. Now by force, we mean there will be acceleration. So if there is a force, there will be acceleration, means velocity of the charge particle will be increasing as it is moving. As the charge particle is moving towards the respective electrode, its velocity will increase. So there will be acceleration. So as the electrons are moving towards the anode wire, there will be increase in velocity, means there will be increase in energy of these electrons. So if the external voltage is sufficiently high, means this electric field is sufficiently high that these electrons start making further ionizations. So these electrons, they attain so much energy that they start making further ionizations as they are moving towards the anode wire. So under the influence of the electric field, these electrons will drift towards the anode wire and hence their energy will be increasing because their velocity is increasing as they are moving towards the anode wire. Now, if this external voltage is sufficiently high, means the electric field is sufficiently high that these electrons under the influence of this electric field will make further ionizations as they are moving towards the anode wire. So they become so energetic that they start making further ionizations, and those ionizations are called as secondary ionizations. So primary ionizations are the one which are made directly by the incoming ionizing particle. And secondary ionizations are the one which are made when these electrons are drifting towards the anode wire, and they become so energetic that when they collide with the other atoms of the gas, they ionize those atoms as well. So now, as you have increased the external voltage, these electrons have started to make secondary ionizations, means now more number of electrons will reach the anode. So earlier there were only electrons due to the primary ionizations which were reaching the anode wire, but now in addition to that, the electrons which are produced in secondary ionizations also start to drift towards the anode wire. And hence, the number of electrons flowing in the circuit has increased. Means due to the increase in external voltage, due to increase in this electric field, secondary ionizations have started to come into picture, due to which the number of electrons flowing in this circuit have increased. And if number of electrons increase, means current will increase, and hence the height of the pulse signal will increase. So the height of pulse signal depends upon external voltage.